Welcome to Bethel United Methodist Church Young Adult and Youth Sunday. We are thrilled that you have chosen to join us today for worship as we celebrate our risen Savior, Jesus Christ.
Resurrection Sunday. Thank you for your love and thank you for forgiving our sins. Please heal the sick. Please give hope to those who need it. In Jesus' name, amen.
One night though, we've been made to do it for a night. Only one night though, crying made to do it for a night. Only one night though, only one night though, only one night though. If you cry, you can cry one night. Only one night though, stress you can stress one night. Only one night though, let the tears fall down one night. Only one night though, only one night though. Only one night though. If you cry, make sure that you cry. Only one night though. If you're sad, make sure that you're sad. Only one night though. If you stress, make sure that you stress. Only one night though. Only one night though. Only one night though. Joy comes in the morning. Joy comes in the morning.
Wait for them to get with me. Looking like a brand new day.
Brand new day.
Woo! Say, I can see a brand new day.
Brand new day.
All these blessings come from God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus rose, defeating death for good and bringing eternal life to the world like only he could.
Hallelujah.
My name is Xavier, and this is my Easter speech. Easter morning, bright and fair, tell me God's love and care. Flowers that were gone from view, now awakening, bloom anew. Though God's face I do not see, I will trust his care for me.
Hi, my name is Analea, and my Easter speech is, I serve a risen Savior. I know that he lives today. Whatever men may say, I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And then whenever I need him, he is always near.
Hallelujah.
Early on the first of the week, the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the other disciples returned to their homes.
But
But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. When they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned around and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not touch me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of God for the people of God. You may be seated.
Who have been around on this earth for a few years shorter than I've been here. It's a blessing because the longer I keep living, the more confidence I have that the world's going to be all right. We're going to be in good hands. You've got to be able. You've got to be able to share love, to show love, to encourage the next generation as they come along. Amen? Amen. Oh, it did my heart good. So it's great to be worshiping with you all in God's house. It is good to be here with you all. Welcome to worship here at Bethel United Methodist Church. It's good to be worshiping with all of you here, you know, in person. And it is great to have those of you who are joining us over a screen someplace, worshiping with us or through a speaker someplace. My name is Nalo Hopkins, and I am the pastor here at Bethel United Methodist Church. Today is Easter Sunday. Some folks will greet you and say Happy Resurrection Sunday. Amen. This is Easter Sunday. This is the day that we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But not just the resurrection. We gather together on this day also to celebrate what the resurrection means for us, amen? Because what it means for us is that the claims that Christ made about our God are true. What it means for us is that the ministry of Christ has been vindicated. What it means for us is that what Christ said about a place being prepared for us after we get done dealing with what we are dealing with here, oh, it means that those claims are valid. Oh, we gather to celebrate not just the resurrection, but what the resurrection means for us. And so as we get ready to get into this message this Easter morning, I want us to begin by centering ourselves and let us move into a time of prayer. We thank you, Almighty God, for blessing us with the opportunity to gather together here just one more time. We thank you for all of the ways that you have made your love known to us leading into this moment. We thank you for the people who have been communicators of your great love for us in some way, shape, or form. We thank you for the ways that you have placed your message of love even in the nature that surrounds us. We thank you for all of the ways that you have made your love known to us as we gather here this morning. We thank you for your grace that communicates your love for us. We thank you for your mercy that communicates your love for us. We thank you for all of the blessings that we know, that we can identify, that we have recognized. But we also in this moment thank you for the stuff that we have failed to acknowledge. Thank you for your providence. Thank you for the unrecognized assistance that has helped us along our way. We thank you for it all. And we pray right now that there is something that we can pick up on. We pray right now that there is something that we can grab a hold of. We pray that there is something that reaches deep into our hearts to help us better learn to love you the way that you love us. We pray that there is something in this moment that will help us act like we love ourselves the way that you love us. We pray that there is something that will empower us to be able to love other people the way that you want us to love ourselves. We pray that the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts are found pleasing and acceptable in your sight. This we ask in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And we all say, amen. 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 So, you know, from generation to generation to generation throughout the history of Christianity, there's kind of been this tradition of starting off the Easter services and I wonder if we could join hands with the people who have come before us and the ones who will come after us in taking part in this tradition. And it is simply on Easter morning to offer up this saying and then to hear the response come back to you. And it's like this. When I say he is risen, your response is he is risen indeed. Can we try that this morning? All right, I'm going to give us a three count. I like three counts. One, two, three. He is risen. Oh, we can do a little bit better than that. We can. One, two, three. He is risen. Oh, those are my resurrection people right there. Christ is risen. We gather together to celebrate not just that, but what it means to us. Now, as we do that this morning, there was a lot going on in our scripture lesson today. And I wonder if we could just kind of narrow our focus in on Mary. Mary Magdalene. As we journey through the Easter story this morning, because I think there is something in Mary's story that might be a benefit to all of us. Can we focus on Mary this morning? Let me give you just a little bit of a background about Mary. Mary Magdalene, it is believed that Mary was single. She was a single woman in the Bible time. And we know that because of her name, Mary Magdalene. See, in the Bible times, if she were Mary, she would have been Mary the wife of. If she had had children, she would have been Mary the mother of. But when none of those descriptions would fit you, then they would go with your hometown, where you were from. And Mary is from this place, northwest of Galilee, on the Sea of Galilee, Magdalena. And so we get Mary Magdalene. Y'all know how that is. People still today identify themselves with what part of town they're from. Am I wrong? That's Johnny from the west side. Right, right. Don't leave this area, because once you leave this area, this state, and you tell somebody from Flint, you're going to be a Flintstone. It's going to be part of your name somewhere. That's the Flintstone right there. You know how these names are. Names can be powerful things. They will stay with you, won't they? My goodness, sometimes you got to grow up and leave home to get rid of a nickname. That worked for me. But names have a way of doing that. And so we have Mary Magdalene before us today. And the scripture opens, and Mary is on her way to see her teacher, her rabbi. She's on her way to see Jesus. Jesus is a dear friend of Mary. You see, when Jesus met Mary, she was going through some things. When Mary met Jesus, she was going through some things. Luke tells us that Jesus cast like 7 demons out of Mary. You know, back then, demons could have been anything. It could have been people dealing with some psychological issues. It could have been people dealing with some emotional issues. It could have been people dealing with some addictions. It could have been people dealing with any kind of thing that they could have been struggling with some deep spiritual things, but they said they're struggling with some demons. And as I hear that list of stuff described back then, I wonder if times have changed all that much, because some people are still struggling with some stuff these days. Amen. Mary meets Jesus, and Jesus changes her life. And so, as the scripture opens this day, Mary is out early in the morning on Easter, and she is heading to the tomb. And I wonder if she has the memory of Friday still in her head. Friday, when her friend, her teacher, her rabbi, an innocent man, was tortured and put to death, crucified, brought up on false charges, lied on. I wonder if she has the memories of Friday still in her head as she makes her way through the streets early Easter morning. The hem of her garment is probably still wet from the dew. The sleeves of her garment are probably wet from wiping away tears, but Mary is on her way through this, and really it's kind of a dangerous period of time. You know, this scripture lesson does not cast the men in great light, does it? Mary is going through the streets of Jerusalem. She's on her way to the tomb to pay her respects to Jesus, and I don't know if the young folks still say this. I need to check in with my. Do they still say it's hot out here? No, that's an old one. That's no. Would it work if I said Mary might have been shook? No. It was dangerous still. It was dangerous. The people who crucified Jesus were still in the area. And Mary is on her way through the streets all along, on her way to the tomb to pay her respects to Jesus. And I wonder, how come none of the men went with her? I can't tell you that the men were shook, because they told me that that's not a word anymore. I imagine they were afraid. Mary gets to the tomb all by herself. And she discovers something, that the stone has been rolled away. She She races back and she shares the news with the disciples. She tells them what she has discovered. And the scripture says that Peter and John, the scripture tells us that they say, "Oh, Mary, wait on us. This time we're going to protect you and we're going to walk back down to the tomb with you to make sure nothing happens to you." Now, the scripture don't say that. You know what the scripture says? The scripture says that the men jump up and they run off and they leave her again to go through the streets all by herself on her own again. They run. They don't have a game plan what they're going to do if the people who rolled the stone away and moved Jesus' body are still out there. They just jump up and they run to the tomb. In my head, they're probably looking over their shoulders to make sure that nobody's chasing them. They get to the tomb and they look inside and they see what Mary says is true. The stone has been rolled away and the body of Jesus is nowhere in sight. And then they lock arms and they say, "Mary, come on, you're coming with us. We're going to walk you back to where we are safely to make sure nothing happens to you." They don't do that either. The scripture says that they run off on her again. And there's Mary, heartbroken and grief-stricken. The men show up and they want to validate Mary's claims. Now, some theologians say this. They say that they showed up to validate Mary's word that the tomb was open and that the body was missing, because back then, nobody would take a woman's testimony. It wouldn't have been a valid thing, so they needed men to officially say what they saw. Ain't that some nonsense? Can I just pause this morning just to say this to you all? Oh, my goodness. Sometimes the truth is the truth. I don't care who's saying it. You know, sometimes we believe a lot of nonsense because of the person that's out there saying this stuff. It's somebody that we respect or we like or we want to follow behind, and so we let it float on by. But the truth is the truth. We live in a world where I turn on the news and I see a lot of nonsense going on. Especially these days. But the truth is an equal opportunity employer. I don't care who it is that is saying it. It's the truth. Mary's word was true. Jesus was missing. And so now she's in the tomb, and her heart is broken, and she is filled with grief. And this part of the story has always, it bothered me at one point in time. We have Mary, and she is grief-stricken. She doesn't know where Jesus is. Her homeboys took off on her, and she's there. They still use homeboys. Homeboys took off on her. And she's there, just trying to make sense of all of this. You know, there is this thing about grief. Sometimes when you are dealing with grief, all you can do is just put one foot in front of the other. Take it one step at a time. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Have you ever had to deal with grief? Sometimes the best thing you can do is just put one foot in front of the other. Take it one step at a time. Sometimes the best thing you can do is just get to the places and the spaces where, I don't know, you used to feel God was close to you. Get to the places and the spaces where life used to make a little bit of sense for you. Just get there. Mary is there. She just wanted to be close to her teacher one more time. So she's sitting there in the tomb. The other people left, but Mary is just there. And then someone starts to ask her some questions. She notices suddenly that there are some people speaking to her, and what they are asking her is, "Why are you crying?" This question used to bother me. Can I be honest with you all on Easter, you all? This question used to bother me. Why are you crying, Mary? What do you mean, why am I crying? You know what just happened on Friday. You know the weight that I am carrying with me. You understand that Saturday was a blur, and I barely recognize that it's Sunday right now. What do you mean, why am I crying? You know, they say that there are no such things as stupid questions. My teacher told me that. It's last question. Oh, but I'm not sure about this one. If you can't cry in the tomb, where can you cry at? If that wasn't a moment for Mary to express her sorrow, then when is the appropriate moment? Why are you crying? I am crying because I don't know where the body of Jesus is. I am crying because even if I knew where the body of Jesus was, I still would have lost my teacher and my rabbi. I'm crying because I'm sad. There's a moment to feel your feelings and to feel your sorrow. Amen? That question used to bother me. In my mind, I imagine Mary is almost going to tell the first people to ask the question off. But then there's a stranger who comes along and asks the question again. And the stranger says the same thing. Mary, why are you crying? And this time, Mary understands something else is happening. This time, Mary gets it. Mary says, well, I'm crying because they've taken the body of my friend, and I don't know where he is. And it's then that Jesus says to Mary, Mary. He calls her by name. And it is in hearing her name that she finally begins to understand some things. It is in hearing her name that she finally begins to understand that the unthinkable is thinkable. It is in hearing her name that she finally begins to understand that the resurrection is, well, possible in some way. I'm reminded of something that Jesus says over in John when Jesus says, my sheep will hear my voice when I call them by name. My goodness. She hears her name. You know, I used to be frustrated when I would read the Bible and they would ask that question, Mary, why are you crying? And have you ever read the Bible and then one day it just makes sense to you? I remember reading one day and it began to dawn on me that they weren't asking her why she was crying as a way of kind of posing an unreasonable question. What they were saying to her was, Mary, is there really a reason for you to be crying? Mary, this isn't a sorrowful occasion. Mary, this is an occasion filled with joy. Mary, you are no longer in Friday. Mary, it is Easter morning. Mary, this is no longer a story about the crucifixion. This is a story about the resurrection. Oh, my goodness. In other words, Mary, you are missing out on what God is doing in this moment. Have you ever had that moment in your life where you wanted God to do one thing? And that was it. You had made your mind up. In order to know that God was at work in your life, this thing had to happen this way at this time, and you have it all figured out. And you haven't recognized that God is already at work. And God is doing way more than what it is you are asking God to do. Sometimes we will miss what God is doing because we haven't recognized that God is at work in our lives. Jesus calls her by name. And suddenly she begins to understand some things. Can I just say that this would not have happened if Mary had left the tomb with the other disciples? That none of this would have happened unless Mary stayed exactly where it was she needed to be? Let that sink in this morning. Can you wrap your hearts around that this morning? There are some places and some spaces in your life where you are waiting on God to move, and sometimes you just need to stay there until it's Easter for you. You need to stay there. Stay in the place where you know that you have been close to God at some point in time. Stay there until you discover that Christ is right there by your side calling your name. You have to stay until it's Easter. You have to stay until you have wrapped your heart around the understanding that we have a Christ who lives. Stay until you understand that joy comes in the morning. You have to stay. Sometimes it is simply just putting one foot in front of the other and just doing the best you can. But stay right there where God is. And so we celebrate the resurrection this morning. Not just the fact that Jesus is risen, but we celebrate what it means for us to celebrate. We celebrate the fact that because there is a resurrection, we understand that the places and the spaces that we think are dead are never dead to God. Oh, we understand that we have a God who is capable and possible of resurrection. If you're here this morning, you've come and the only thing you can do is put one foot in front of the other. If you're here this morning and you're not at full Easter faith yet, that is okay. You are in the right place. Just stay. Stay close to God. You are not in this world on your own. Christ is there calling you by name. I'm getting ready to close. I remember hearing once about a man who had gotten into an argument with three different people at the same time. Then finally he had a moment of clarity and he drew a line in the sand. And then he looked at the biggest person out of the three. And he said to the biggest person out of the three, step across this line. And after the biggest one stepped across the line, the man looked at the other two and said, you're in trouble now because this guy is on my side. Oh. Easter is understanding the God that's on your side. Understanding what it means for you. The worst thing that happens in this life is never the last thing, because with Christ, the resurrection is the last thing. Evil never has the final say in this world, because with Christ, love and mercy and the grace of God has the last word in this world. So I am going to give us one more time to try it again this Resurrection Sunday, this Easter morning. I'm going to say he lives Christ is risen. And I want you all to say, Christ is risen indeed. All right, let's try it again. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Happy Easter, everybody. Let the church say amen. So this is the time of the service where we extend an invitation to discipleship. We invite you, if you are so moved by the Spirit, to stand up, to make your way up here to the front of the church. If you want prayer, the altars are available for you for prayer. If you're looking for a church home, Bethel's a great place. We give you that opportunity right here, right now. If you want to take your relationship with God to the next level and you're just saying, you know what, there's some things that I want to get out of the way so that I can just focus on my faith journey and my spiritual walk, you can come on down. And we'll pray with you. We'll pray for you. This is the time.
Lord, I lift my name up. Lord, I lift your name up high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. A debt you pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lifting your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. From heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, a debt you pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, a debt you pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. One more time. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the ground to the sky, a debt you pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift the name on high.
Let us pray. O God, who meets us where we are, Oh God, who calls us by name and does not stop calling us until we recognize that we are not alone. Oh God, who sends the powerful Spirit as our comforter and as our waymaker, we give you thanks right now, this moment. And we pray. We pray that we are able to continue putting one foot in front of the other until we are able to run and share the message that the tomb is empty. To share the message that Christ is risen. To share the message that resurrection is possible. To share the message that we are people of Easter faith. We pray, Almighty God, that what we have received here will make a difference in our lives and in the people we share this world with. We ask this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Let the church say, amen. Thank you, brother.
Children are reported to Sunday school wing immediately following service for their Easter egg hunt. There is an Easter backdrop set up in the parlor to take photos immediately following after service. If you need a ride to church on the first or third Sundays, please call the office by Thursday before 2:30 p.m. Sunday, April 27th at 9:30 a.m., Easter Winds District, United Women in Faith Prayer Breakfast and Spiritual Growth Event. Location, Calvary UMC, 211 Flushing Road. Flint 485-04. Speaker, Pastor Audra Hudson Stone. Message, Environmental Jester, A Call to Hope in Action. PC Sally Perry, if interested. COVID testing is every Tuesday and Wednesday from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. and Thursday from 1 p.m. to 7 p.m. Everyone is encouraged to get COVID tested weekly. Birthdays. March 31st, Wanda Lyon. April 1st, Taylor Price, and April 22nd. And April 2nd, Kathleen Jones.
Can we sing happy birthday to them today? Ready? Go.
Welcome, guest. We want to extend our warmest welcomes to our guest. We are so blessed to have you. Community prayer. Please continue to pray for the following: Kathleen Jones, Charles Newton, Donald Ricks, Janice Harden, Ronaldo Curtis Woodson, Maddie Andrews, Minnie Hester Monroe Murphy III.
Thank you for coming today.
for coming today.
Bethel family and friends, I'm going to ask that you give another round of applause for our staff that helped today with Sunday school. Family and friends, thank you so much. I don't know if you realize, but it takes a lot of work to do what we've done today. And I just want to thank you for your support and your love. We appreciate it. And have a happy Resurrection Sunday.
And I'm going to let them sit with their parents. What I was going to do was ask all the children that gave their speeches to come back up so that we could show them how much we appreciated them again. But what I'm going to ask you to do is just kind of show them some love one more time. Oh. If you remember those Easter speeches when you were little, but oh my goodness. Now we are moving to our moment in ministry where we have an opportunity to give. And so if you want to give digitally, there are some ways to do it on a screen in front of you. PayPal at Flint Bethel UMC and Cash App at Flint Bethel UMC. If you're doing it the old-fashioned way, there's a blessing box right over there on the door by Gary, right? Just right that way. Let's pray. We'll bless the offering now. God, if you hadn't given it to us, we wouldn't have it. Everything that we have comes from you, and so we thank you for being so generous. We thank you for giving and giving and giving. We thank you for supplying all of our needs. And so now, we offer back just a portion of what it is that you already blessed us with. We raise it before you with our prayers that you will continue to let people know that your truth is your truth. No matter who is speaking it, we raise it praying that you will continue to help people who are coming to you still in various stages of grief. Know that you are still there calling them by name. We raise this offering before you with the prayers that it will run forth into the world to communicate the good news of your gospel. Bless it to let the world know that Christ is risen. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Let us all say amen. So, I'm going to invite you to stand and we're going to give the benediction. But let me make sure I got this right. There's an Easter egg hunt someplace? Did I get that right? I don't think we're supposed to tell them where it is, right? Don't they have to hunt for it? Okay, all right. You don't have to hunt for the Easter egg hunt. You just have to hunt for the eggs once you get there. Okay, all right. Please stand as you are able. Wait, I didn't tell them where it was. Where's the hunt? Okay, it's in the Sunday school wing. Okay, so that's two different places. Okay, oh, okay, there we go. All right. Sunday school, it's all in the Sunday school wing. In the backdrop, in the parlor, take your Easter pictures. Okay, receive this benediction. And now may the grace of God, may the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, may the peace of Christ rest, rule, and abide with you all this day and evermore. Let us all say, amen. Amen.